So the first topic, decentralized finance. DeFi is just a collective term, and it refers to the shift from traditional finance to decentralized finance. And what that means is the activities are still the same, like borrowing, lending, you know, trading, saving. However, rather than being on, you know, done through institutions and banks, it's done through open sourced programmable technologies on the blockchain, specifically on the Ethereum blockchain. That's where it's kind of all taking place. So it's pretty interesting. Just to get a little perspective, we can compare the two, DeFi and traditional finance. DeFi, the technology that powers DeFi, is open source and can be scrutinized by anybody. And also, because, you know, we went over dApps yesterday. So DeFi is powered, you know, by dApps and smart contracts. And so the technology is always going to be open source and can always be viewed by everybody. Everything is public. And there's more accessibility because of this underlying technology. There's more accessibility to financial services. It's not limited to just, you know, like in traditional finance, typically you'd have to go to either a venture capital firm or private equity. And there might be some, you may need to have a minimum asset requirement. So in DeFi, it's much more accessible. Anybody can start lending and borrowing. And we'll talk about how that's able to work. Also, when it comes down to interest rates, DeFi, the interest rates are adjusted automatically based on the supply and demand. Whereas in traditional finance, the interest rates are controlled, at least in the United States, by the Fed, and it's controlled by some people, whereas the market controls the interest rates in DeFi. And one of the biggest features, which is so critical, is security. We learned yesterday that the blockchain system, security is built into the blockchain system, the decentralized system, whereas in traditional finance, the security systems have had to be retrofitted to older systems. And of course, the traditional financial system has been around even before the technology existed. So this leads to very clunky, complicated security systems that are very, with high chances of fraud and cyber attacks. As we can see, there's been a lot of cyber attacks in recent years. One of the major cons, though, of decentralized finance is right now its lack of scalability, because the systems that were built were not built for large scale operations yet, not yet at least. And so it's resulting in high gas fees, where gas fees are kind of like transaction fees that should only be in fractions of a penny, but some of them can be pretty expensive due to the lack of scalability. But now the decentralized market has grown 10 times in the last year alone. So they've quickly uncovered one of the problems, which is scalability. Whereas in traditional finance, the institutions have been around for forever. So they're at a level where they can scale up, and most decision-making is handled by the institutions. Whereas in DeFi, it's done a little bit differently. So that's pretty much the difference. You can see that DeFi is trying to attempt to fill in some of the, what do you call it, the holes that are in traditional financial system using technology. And so let's go into some of the different activities that you can do in DeFi. Again, it's all kind of the same things that you can do, but again, the process is different. So one thing that's interesting is, you know, with sending money, you can send anybody anywhere, anytime using the wallet systems. And it feels very similar to sending money through Zelle or Venmo. In this case, it's done through cryptocurrency. And that process is very much the same, but there's this, I've never heard of this, it's called streaming money, where you can actually stream money to somebody on a second by second level. So for example, if you are paying an employee or a contractor to do work, you can pay them second by second and just have money constantly streaming to them. The benefit of this is, well, especially on the receiving end, you can have access to your funds in almost real time. And it's also beneficial if you want to do short-term renting. If you need to rent out some space, some storage space for a day, or you just want to rent out a public bike, you can use this streaming money system to take care of short-term renting. And so what you can also do is, what people are doing is utilizing stablecoins. And this will let you send and stream money without having to deal with the volatile cryptocurrency market, the constant fluctuations. So with stablecoin, you can just send and receive money without dealing with the constant fluctuations in the market. So I thought that was pretty cool, the concept of streaming money. I had never heard of it up until reading about that. So another activity, you know, like borrowing. So with borrow, you know, in DeFi, you can borrow without needing any to show any kind of identity or even any credit score. All you need is just to put upfront some collateral. So in the event that you're not able to pay your loans back, that collateral, immediately you lose the collateral. And there's two ways that people are borrowing now. Number one is peer-to-peer. You can borrow from a specific lender. And another way is you can do some pool-based lending, you know, pool-based borrowing. So lenders will get together and provide funds in, you know, into a liquidity, into a pool that lenders can borrow from. And right here, I just took a screenshot of the Ethereum page that shows the different applications that are allowing lending and borrowing. No, it's on the left side over here. These are just some of them, which we saw yesterday, right? AAVE and Oasis. So it's very easy to get into. You could literally just sign up and start playing with it. Actually, you don't even need to sign up. You can just use your wallet and get going. So it's much quicker now. And with lending, so on the flip side, if you want to become a lender, you can lend out your cryptocurrency and start to earn interest on it. So again, a product like AAVE, the way it works is, you know, you lend your coins to the product and then you receive tokens representing your loaned coins. Remember the tokenization. And then from there, your tokens. So for example, if you're lending out, let's say 100 DAI, right? DAI, it's one of the famous stable coins, right? So let's say you lend out 100 DAI and then in exchange, you receive 100 A DAI, right? ADAI. And that those A DAI tokens represent your coin, the DAI coins that you lent out, right? And so as you lend out, you know, as the lending process happens, you can accumulate interest on those tokens. So your tokens will increase based on the interest rates. So if you had 100 tokens, then you can have, you know, 100.123 or such and so forth, depending on the interest rates. And then you can withdraw your money at any time. So that's a little bit of how the lending process works. There's another interesting thing I found called no loss lotteries. And with no loss lotteries, you enter into a pool and you deposit your coins and you receive the tokenized lotto tickets. Then there's a lottery. And if one of your tickets is picked, then the balance that you've invested will increase based on the size of the pool. And if you don't win, your ticket just gets rolled into the lottery for next week and you can withdraw anytime. So really the only thing you're not really losing, you're just not gaining. And then you have a chance to win big rather than steadily accumulating interest. And the pools are generated by the interest that's generated from lending out the deposits. So there's one example called Pool Together, I think is the main or one of the bigger, more famous lending and no loss lottery pools. And it's all right there on the Ethereum site. Another DeFi activity is, you know, exchanging tokens. So on a decentralized exchange, otherwise known as a DEX, it's similar to, you know, if you ever travel overseas and you can exchange one currency for the other, it's kind of a similar feel to that. So, you know, this is good when, if you want to enter into a lottery from the other page or pretty much any transaction that you want to engage in, if it's different, if it has a different coin from what you have. And here you can kind of see the process of how it works. You just, let's say you're using Ethereum, you select the token that you want and you can slot and you can swap it. So if you need to swap out Ethereum for DAI, you know, this will let you do it. Now, I'm not sure if that counts as, you know, like a trading scenario where you would incur a capital gain on the swap. I'm not entirely sure how that process works, but this is pretty much how the exchange rate would work in the crypto world. So pretty cool. Is everything clear so far? The different activities? I think there's a few more. Yeah, so far it's pretty much the overall idea is same as what you normally do, just process is much now faster and more secure too. So crowdfunding, when you do crowdfunding now, the investors can come from pretty much anywhere. And unlike in traditional finance, it's transparent. So you can, if you're a funder, you can actually trace how the funds are expended later on. And one thing I thought that was pretty cool was that you can set up deadlines using, and this is, by the way, this is all done using smart contracts. You can actually set up deadlines where if, you know, the recipient of your funds, if they don't meet the deadlines or the minimum requirements,
it'll automatically refund it to you. So it really reduces the chance of losing out on money that you might lend out. And so those are pretty much some of the main DeFi activities. Again, so just to recap, DeFi or decentralized finance is just, it's just the decentralized way of doing the typical financial activities that we already know about. And, you know, the way to do it is, you just go through the Ethereum blockchain and you can find these different apps, you know, decentralized apps that are powering these kinds of DeFi activities. So it's pretty cool. So any questions on DeFi before we move on?
Just for swapping, it's the same as the converting one coin to another coin in exchanges.
It is the same.
Tax issue is the same. Yeah.
Okay, good to know. So it is the same. Swapping is the same as converting. Okay. So it will incur a capital gain. Good to know. Thank you, Daniel. All right. So let's move into part two. All right. So that's everything for today. And if you have any questions, please leave a comment. Thank you.